is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The Revolution with Juan McCartney is sponsored by Baja Retreat and Spa, Burger King, Commonwealth Bank, J.S. Johnson, NUA Insurance Agents and Brokers, The Owen Foundation, Popeyes, and Ron's Electric Motors.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. Today we're going to be talking current affairs, but we got a couple of things lined up first. First, let me tell you that Baja Retreat Spa is celebrating Spa Week this week until Saturday. The Spa Week gift certificate start at $50. Stop by and purchase a gift certificate at their location on East Bay Street. Call them at 323-6711 or purchase a gift certificate online at www.baharetreat.com. You can get massages, facials, manicures, and pedicures, body sugaring, the best deals ever starting at just $50. During Spa Week, you get 20% off and more on all retail products like Eminence or those, 50% off on PPEs, mask sanitizers, and much more. It's Spa Week time, and you deserve the best. Check them out. They have the best Spa Week ever. Spa Week gift certificates valid for 1 year. Again, call them at 323-6711. WhatsApp them at 544-1855. You can also contact them at the website, baharetreat.com. You can also find them on Facebook and Instagram. And don't forget to purchase your Spa Week gift certificates online at www.baharetreat.com. All right, so we're going to start off the show today talking about something that I think is an important initiative that's going on. I have a friend of mine whose son is involved in the JBLN baseball league, and for a very long time during the pandemic, they really couldn't have the kids out, and they lost a lot of steam and a lot of good skills and development training. And JBLN has been back for some time now, and the type of guy my friend is, he's deeply involved in it. Anything to do with his son, he's going to get hands-on. And he's started a new initiative to really help the kids to grow. So we're going to talk about that, and we're going to be talking today with Stephen Bishop Beneby, who is a board member at JBLN. They're really focusing, this initiative, JBLN Reloaded, is focusing on kids 12 and under, boys and girls, and really trying to enhance the skill level to the kids, getting back to the basics of baseball, teaching fundamentals and proper techniques, throwing, batting, base running, knowing the game. So this JBLN Reloaded, it's in the facilities and helping the kids out. There's a sauce out going on this Saturday. And I got a few tickets to give away. I got chicken sauce tickets, and I got sheep tongue sauce tickets. And I also got some tickets to sell. So my corporate people out there, my people who want to do something to help the kids, JBLN being internally funded, we want you to help out with the Reloaded program. We want you to give back to the community as best you can. So sheep tongue sauce tickets are $15. Chicken sauce tickets are $10. I'm going to give them away to some people. But really, what we want is people who are interested in helping out an initiative for boys and girls. But particularly our boys, we want to make sure that they can have outlets for their energy. We want to make sure that they can be properly socialized, taught discipline. Sport is one of the great ways to do that. And baseball is also something that's paying a lot of dividends for Bahamian kids going up through college and even into the major league. So, Bishop, good to have you with us. Tell us about what JBLN Reloaded is doing.
Well, thanks, Juan, for having me.
Absolutely.
Good day, Bahamas. One, I'd like to first mention that JBLN has finished its draft for the 2022-23 season. But in a matter of days, all those persons who've been drafted, who've applied for play at JBLN, both boys and girls, they will be contacted by their coaches. By the end of this week, they should be in contact with all of them. Or for all those parents who are now waiting now to pay, you can either pay online at jbln.com. We are open all on a daily basis and all day on Saturday. You can pay by cash, but we prefer if you come and pay by check. We're trying to go cashless in the very near future. There's a lot of capital projects going on now at JBLN as we try to improve the facilities going forward. And our program, which is an offshoot from JBLN itself, which is to cater to young kids, the younger kids, those between the ages of 8 to 12. Basically, we're working on two categories, an HU category and a 10U category. We still have some guys who are in transition, moving from 10 to 12U, and they are part of the program. JBLN Reloaded was the brainchild about five guys who went off to a tournament last year at Perfect Games, earlier this year, I should say. And after the tournament was over, we sat down in the lobby and they discussed going forward and trying to improve the play at JBLN. And they thought that if we started at the younger age, if we catch the kids at a young age, they shouldn't be a problem. As they called me out of the room and they asked me to come down and be a part of that group, and I went down. I was very glad. Right to this day, I'm very glad that I did go. You know, my concentration has always been on developing girls softball. But now they trapped me and get me into this one, and I'm glad I'm there, Juan.
Right.
Now, the Reloaded program, the purpose of that, and you spoke about it briefly, is to get boys, basically boys. We have a few girls. We have about five or six girls in the program at that age, but it's basically all about those boys. And we don't only want to develop their skills as a baseball player. We also want to develop and promote the educational part of their upbringing. Now, we have come up with a project whereby we pick out some of the more brilliant guys who we had some students at QC who recently had like 6 A's and 7 A's. But we have a bulletin board that we're going to put up, and we want to put them on that and put up their grades, put a picture of them, put up their grades, and let them know that we are trying to develop the whole person, not only the baseball part of it. And that is ongoing. Like I said, the purpose of the Reloaded group is to develop the whole person as a baseball player. Being an umpire at JBLN for so many years, I hear the 12U coaches, especially the 12U coaches and the 14-year coaches, they have a legitimate gripe. They should not be teaching a guy at that age how to bunt, how to throw. They should already have that down pat. And what we are doing now with our Reloaded program, we are trying to, in a better frame, we are trying to put them in a better frame of mind and also get them ready physically. So what we do is we will go in for the last 6 weeks. We will go in every Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday. But now that all the teams have been, all the players have been put on different teams, we are going to cut our Reload program down to about Saturdays, where we have from 10 until 1. But I would still be there on the regular Mondays and Wednesday to assist them with that. Like you mentioned also, Juan, the Reloaded group is really self-funded. Okay? We come up with our own funds to do different things to promote play at JBLN. It's all about JBLN. And we're having this South Side on the weekend. We're hoping that the public will come out and support us. We want to be able to put ourselves in a position to help assist in some of the major projects that JBLN as a whole will be carrying on. And right now, we just finished completing one of the bleachers. Over the past, 2 years where we've been down, the bleachers deteriorated, so we are putting up some new stuff now and doing some improvement to the park, and we feel as though, as a group from Reloaded, we'll be able to assist with that. So this South South and also a car wash would be taking place on Saturday. The menu is chicken and sheep tongue. We also, at this young age, we are trying to get more parents involved in what we're doing. Okay? We're trying to get away where parents just come, drop the kids off to practice and go and then come back and make it seem as though it's a babysitting thing.
Mm-hmm.
No, we want them also involved. Okay? And there's a lot of parents out there who have a lot to offer. They may not be able to teach the kids how to play the game fundamental, but some of the ventures that we want to go into, they'll be able to assist us very ably in that. Okay? We are also, like I said, the draft is finished. Right now we have a 10U team that's ready to play some other competition. So we reached out to some of the family islands, and we are trying to get them to commit to come down and play some interleague games. We are going to try to put ourselves in a position where we'd be able to assist them, maybe at hotel accommodation, ground transportation, that sort of stuff.
The family island teams.
Family island teams.
10 and under.
10 and under.
Gotcha.
We also have on our schedule, we're in contact with some coaches in the Florida area and also out of New York. We want to bring down coaches who would be able to teach the fundamentals of the game and interact with the kids to see what we have and let them know that we are now going to track these kids as they develop and keep them on a database. We have somebody just assigned to do that, to make sure we keep all the stats, et cetera, so that we can pass those on to those managers or any of the coaches that come down who need this information. With these guys who will be coming down, we have a pitching coach. We're also trying to bring down a fielding coach so we can develop our players to that much, to a higher level. We're also trying to seek some corporate sponsors, not only for the Reloaded group, but also for the JBLN as a whole. So any help we can get, they can contact us at JBLN. Jodell Roberts is the overall person dealing with sponsorship, etc. at JBLN. They can contact her. Yeah. Or if you deal with the Reloaded group, you can contact Mithala Kalma. Yeah. She's the one responsible for the Reloaded crew.
Yeah, and I got her. I'll give her information out, too. You can contact her about the South South, too. I know Jeff Albury did a lot of work with JBLN, and he was really the backbone of it.
He was the backbone of JBLN, and he's sorely missed.
Right, absolutely.
Especially now that we're here and we're getting into getting the season off the ground, et cetera. Since that time, Shane Albury has been appointed now the commissioner.
Okay.
And he has his hand full. We're trying to get all the teams allotted and getting a schedule prepared, because in the very near future we're going to begin our preseason games,
right.
And we're looking forward to that. And I guess all the kids are looking forward to that. We want to let people know that once you're a part of JBLN, and you are at that age level, you're welcome to be a part of Reloaded, because all it is teaching guys more skills. Because the coaches that we have now at JBLN are doing a tremendous job, but we want to assist them.
Mm-hmm.
If we could make it easier on a kid going up to the higher group in the play, we could teach them the basic fundamentals at that level, it's going to help the game to be a better game.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I got to ask you this about JBLN. When did JBLN start?
Well, JBLN has been in existence for now the last 36 years.
Okay, 36 years.
36 years.
Wow. Okay, crazy. And so, where do you go to go to the South South, to go out to the field?
Okay.
How do you get to St. Andrews Field?
St. Andrews, well,
everybody
should know where St. Andrews Field is, and we are located in the back of St. Andrews. We have a lot of people don't know about JBLN right. and where it is.
Right.
And it's on the Eastern Road. And once you pass St. Andrews, which is opposite Solomon's and that area, mm-hmm. you take the first left. And I always tell people, when you take the first left after you pass St. Andrews, after you come to the third speed bump, mm-hmm. take that first left.
That's it.
And you'll drive into the complex.
Right.
And you'll be amazed to see what we have done down there.
Yeah.
And the works that's going on to try and improve that facility even more.
Yeah, I've been there before, but it's been a minute. All right, so the South Side is this weekend. It's $15 for sheep tongue and $10 for chicken. You can go out there, you can get your car washed by the Reloaded Kids.
Yes.
It's from 8 a.m. to 12 noon out at JBLN. So I'm going to give away a few tickets. And then I'm also going to have some tickets that if you want to purchase them, reach out to me, and you can get some Southside tickets, and we'll, of course, hand that over to JBLN. I want to thank you for coming through, Bishop. It's a really good initiative that you got going on. You're really helping the kids, and you've done so much for the girls for so many years, and now they roped you into helping the boys, and I'm glad of it.
The thing about it, when they called me down, when we was away at the hotel, the guys called me down, and one of the directors who was involved in this program, the Reloaded program, he said, Bishop, you got to give up them girls. That's a hard thing to do after all these years, you
right.
know, because that has been my focus. My wife has been there by my side the whole time. And right now we have a crew of girls that we are working with to develop them also. I can't give that up.
Right.
I got to work, you know, spend some time with them. So you'll come up. We'd like to invite all of you out to the South Side on the weekend. Help us to make it a success. You're going to see a lot of young kids, and they're going to be wearing their new Reloaded shirts. What we did is one of the initiatives we did, we gave each kid in the program two shirts. Mm. We don't charge you for that.
Excellent.
We can charge the parents, so they can pay a little something for their own, but everybody's welcome, and all the kids, you're going to see them. They're going to enjoy themselves, and like I said, this is an ongoing project. We want to work hand in hand with JBLN and assist them wherever possible in some of the major things that they're trying to accomplish at the field.
Yeah.
And to any of the corporate sponsors out there, at the sound of my voice, who can assist us at JBLN, please feel free to do. Like I said, Jordison.
Yeah, and you can also contact Dahlia Culmer.
Dahlia Culmer, yes, from the Reloaded Program.
From the Reloaded Program, and you can reach out to her at 556-5384. Someone's asking me if there is any RBC account you can donate to, or any bank account you can donate funding to. Not sure if you have that set up yet, but you can contact Dahlia Culmer, and she can help you out. So this says, your guest should clarify, the field is off of Yamacraw Hill Road and is off Winton Meadows Subdivision Road, accessible via the St. Andrews back gate.
Yes.
Yeah. So
correct.
That's where we are with that. All right, so I'd urge you to help the kids. I'm going to, like I say, give away a couple tickets later in the show. We're going to do a bit of trivia, and I'm also going to have some tickets here for sale. So all you guys out there who talk about wanting to help the community, want to do stuff, this is a good way to contribute, and let me know. I'll collect the funds on behalf of JBLN and send it to them. My friend who's involved, he knows where I live, so you don't have to worry about the money, yes. not making it to the kids.
Juan, I want to thank you for this opportunity.
I thank you for coming.
And anybody out there who have kids, just reach out to me. You know, I've been retired from BEC for the last 10 years, and I've dedicated my life, remaining part of my life, to helping those kids out, give back. Any of those senior players out there who've been playing baseball and now retired and want to come out and lend a hand, you're welcome.
Absolutely.
Because we don't know it all, and we can't do it all. Help is always welcome.
Right. I'm going to try to get my son out there, too, but I was like you said, the draft is done. So I'm gonna
see. That's a good excuse, Juan. But anyhow.
Exactly.
Thank you very much.
All right, Bishop. Appreciate you coming.
Thank you, buddy.
Good to see you, as always. We're going to go to a break, and we'll be right back after this.
J-S. Johnson Insurance agents are the best. Reliable service we've been on the scene, protecting since 1988. S. Johnson Insurance has the test. Always, you're always covering me. JSJ. S. Johnson Insurance, peace of mind.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
If you were exposed to COVID-19, have symptoms, or traveled recently, get tested so that you can have peace of mind about your status. Just visit one of our convenient locations on New Providence at the University of the Bahamas or Golden Gates Plaza, weekdays 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Saturdays 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. On Eleuthera at the Three Island Dock, Mondays through Thursdays 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., Fridays and Saturdays, 8 a.m. to 7 p.m., and Sundays, 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. On Exuma at the Regatta Park, weekdays, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., Saturdays, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Sundays, 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. On Abaco at Maxwell Food Store, Mondays through Saturdays, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The COVID-19 test results will be ready in 15 minutes, and the tests are free.
This message is brought to you by PAHO WHO and the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
It's Spa Week, we got what you need. Sit back, relax, and come in for a treat. We just want to make you smile. We will go the extra mile. Baja Treat Spa.
Come visit us at Baja Treat Spa on East Bay Street. Contact us at 323-6711 or visit us online at www.baharetree.com.
You do coffee your way.
Double shot, decaf, cappuccino.
Light roast, Colombian, no milk.
You do vacations your way.
Hiking boots, tent, mountains.
Five-star hotels and theater.
And now you can do insurance your way.
Online.
Email.
Chat.
WhatsApp.
Or in branch. For home, car, travel, boat, or business insurance, do it anyway with NUA Insurance agents and brokers. Visit NUAinsurance.com, call, or stop by a branch today.
Fidelity's free Women Plus seminar is back. Join us on Saturday, October 29th at the Bahama Convention Center, where leading professionals will give you the hard facts on topics like
How to Be Rich 101, how your mental and emotional health impact financial health, and what I wish women knew about men,
and how to get their money. This free life-changing event is for women and men. The seminar includes breakfast, 8 sessions, plus over $8,000 in prizes and surprises. Registration and breakfast begins at 8 a.m. with sessions from 9:30 a.m. to 2 p.m.
Space is limited, so register now for free at fbbwomenplus.com.
Okay, class, let's begin today's history lesson. Ancient civilization used to visit stadiums to watch musicians perform. It was called a live concert.
What was that?
Researchers believe it was around 2019. Normal life feels like a long time ago. As things return to normal, remember it is essential to be fully immunized against all vaccine-preventable diseases like COVID-19, rubella, polio, hepatitis, mumps, and influenza. This message is brought to you by PAHO WHO, the Ministry of Health and Wellness, the Caribbean Development Bank, the Government of Canada, and the United States of America.
afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Radio 96.9 FM. Actually, someone has sent me banking information for JBLN. So I'm going to forward that to those who asked for it. Okay, so we are going to talk about a couple issues today. I'm going to put this out there for you so that you can score yourself some tickets to the Souse Out. I'll do a chicken and a sheep tongue each for whoever can get this. The first one is, how long has JBLN been in existence? Junior Baseball League of Nassau. How long has it been in existence? Answer that question for me. I don't know if you're paying attention. Answer that question for me, and I'll get you a sheep tongue and a chicken souse ticket. You can go out there this weekend, 8 to 12, and get your souse as well as get your car washed. One of my friends who's involved says that he guarantees the souse will be top-notch. All right. For those of you, I guess a lot of people are into sheep tongue. I'm not a sheep tongue person. Oh, I'm sorry. You have to call. You have to call and say how long it's been in existence. Call me. 323-6232. I don't mind. More than one person can call. 323-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. All right. So riddle me that, and you can get yourself a sheep tongue and a chicken. Oh, this person said they're at work. I can't go. All right, I'm going to write your number down. So what's your, you who said you're at work, what's your name? I'm going to write your name on the back of these tickets. Does Naughty tell you text to get giveaways? I can't. That's hard to keep track of. Send me your name. Okay, I'm going to write your name on the back of these tickets. And we got a call. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Yeah, well, please, yeah.
36 years. Okay, you're right. Kermit, get the gentleman's name. He just texted to me, and I'm going to go ahead and write it on the back of these tickets. I'll leave them downstairs at the front desk at the Guardian, okay? Okay, great. Kermit, yeah. Hook that up for me, and we'll go. So I got this texter who I'm going to give these tickets to, and we got this gentleman who we're going to give those tickets to. Now, I'm a... I'm a hard judge of souse, but my friend tells me he's got it on lock. Hold on, give me a sec. See, this is the thing. That's why it's hard for me to do it, because you got to. If I don't do it now, I'll forget. So I got to do it right now. Okay, here we go. Okay, so. All right, you do that, and then you do. Let me know the guy's name. You okay? I'll give you. What's your name? He says, "Mother of God." No. What's your name? Let me know, and I'll give you the tickets. You who texted me, "Mother of God." No. All right. So second question. Oh, okay. I got your name. I got you. One chicken for you. One sheep tongue for you. Got to be something in the Bible about not eating, like, something's tongue. Or hoof. Got it, right? Like, I see these people eating pig feet. I'm like, God can't be pleased with that. That's not normal. All right, I got you. I got you right here. All right. Now, if you want to purchase some tickets, you can also hit me up. Let me know who you are, and Kermit can. You can call Kermit at 302-2314. Let me know if you want to purchase some tickets. I'm trying to get some money for the kids there. All right. Cool. Second question is, let me know if you can do this. I'll give you some souse tickets. Second question is, where's JBLN located? Say a text. Don't repeat text me now. You can call me 323-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. All right. Where's JBLN located? All right. For those who want to donate, I got the RBC account number, and you can go from there. I got Mice House tickets. I got all chicken. I'm not bringing sheep tongue into my house. I don't know that that's a Christian thing to do. So I'm just not gonna do it. All right, let's talk turkey. Okay, so today's Nassau Gardening, and we'll get into this beforehand. You know, I'm not going to shy away from talking about these things. It's important. And we always get this conversation going on where, oh, we're talking about legal migrants, and we get all, everyone gets touches, right? But I can, if we all leave alone touchy subjects because we're afraid somebody's going to get offended or hurt or something like that, then we'll never get anything done, right? So you guys just navigate as best as we can. And we have a problem on Abaco, which is clear. We got a call, no problem. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon.
Yes, hi.
Hi, you have the answer to two of your questions.
Do you have the answer?
I think it's St. Andrew's Drive.
St. Andrew's what?
Drive.
What do you think, Kermit? Should I give it to her?
come on.
All right. It's St. Andrew's Field.
Oh, please. Oh, okay, St. Andrew's
Field. St. Andrew's Field. Anyway, okay. get her information, Kermit. I'll give you a sheep tongue and a chicken.
Okay, thank you.
All right, cool. Oh, for Jesus' sake, I hung up the phone. I'm so sorry. Call back, ma'am, and Kermit's going to answer you. Call back on that same number. I'm sorry, that's my bad. I did hang up on you. I didn't mean to. And Kermit's going to answer you. All right, let me see. Okay, yeah, you're right. This texter's right. I'll do you one chicken, one sheep tongue. Okay? What does Naughty give away? Send me your name. You who said 30, what's your number? 423-4881. Send me your name. Okay? 423-4881. Send me your name. Get that lady stuff and then we'll do that, Kermit. All right. Anyway, listen, we only have a couple minutes left. Let me say this. Now, you could say that John Pinder is being alarmist or whatever, but I don't live on Abaco and he does, okay? And this is not the first time he said this. He's alluded to this and that the government MP for Central and South Abaco is saying this with such determination. Okay, I got your name. That the government MP is saying this with such determination is something that is quite worrisome. So, all right, we got an issue on Abaco, right? So the issue is multifaceted. But first, let me explain the story to you, and then we can talk about it on the other side. And I'm into, yeah, I want to acknowledge the problem, but I'm into solutions, too. So off top, my solution is not regularize everybody who's illegal and let them work on Abaco. It ain't gonna work, okay? Not gonna work like that. So that's your dream, that we're gonna take everybody who's illegal in Abaco, hey, here you go, you get a work permit, and you, that's not gonna work. That ain't no way to do nothing in decency and order. That's gonna only lead to more confusion, okay? So we have an illegal migration problem on Abaco. Let's talk about it, all right? And I'll also talk about why it's important to address it, all right? So we'll just do this before the 1 o'clock news, and we'll come back and talk about it. It says, the numbers of undocumented Haitians living on Abaco are closing in on the Bahamian population on the island. Central and South Abaco MP John Pinder warned yesterday while calling for stiffer fines for people who employ undocumented migrants. All right, this is written by Jasper Ward. It says, Pinder told the Nassau Guardian, it's been growing for many decades, and it's only growing more. There's a significant number. I wouldn't say how many, but it's a significant number. It could possibly match the Bahamian populace in Abaco now. When asked for an estimate of the island's population, he replied, that's kind of a hard one to say because we're still having an influx of a return of Abaconians who had left after her influx or a return of Abaco who had left after Hurricane Dorian.
We have others who are there throughout the Bahamas for work purposes, so I could not exactly put a figure on that, but I'd say more than 10,000. So more than 10,000. The numbers are closing in on the Bahamian populace in Abaco. More than 10,000 people total, or more than 10,000 illegal migrants? Pinder said the growing undocumented Haitian population is a concern for Abaco residents. In August, then-Haitian chargé d'affaires Anthony Brutus claimed there are 150,000 Haitians living in the Bahamas, which has an estimated population of 400,000. He provided no basis for his estimate. Now, they were called Brutus, if I remember correctly. All right. This says, according to a 2006 International Organization for Migration study, there are an estimated 30,000 to 60,000 Haitians in the Bahamas who are not well integrated into Bahamian society. Okay. A census is ongoing, and preliminary results are expected to be released by the end of the year. It will provide an updated snapshot of the migrant population in the Bahamas. Okay, let me just say something about that. I've never, ever seen a census, and I've read them going back decades. I've never seen a census distinguish between documented and undocumented migrants. Now, the census will give you nationality, okay? But I've never seen a census distinguish between documented and undocumented migrants. And I think that there may be a good reason for that, and that you want people to be as frank and honest with the census as possible. If you have people saying, we're going to avoid the census takers for fear that we're going to be deported, then that's going to cause you a problem to not have a proper census in your country, to make sure that you get people who are undocumented processed, whether that's to be repatriated or they have some claim to citizenship, then you need to deal with it. All right? So we got a problem with thousands and thousands of undocumented migrants on Abaco. It's a problem. Okay? It's a problem. We're going to be back. We're going to talk about that. Stay tuned.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
When you call Crime Stoppers, they just answer your call in Miami.
So then we can report everything? Guns, where they hiding the drugs, who shoot who part of which gang, or who disturbing the peace with the loud music and the motorcycles.
Then our neighborhood will be the best in the Bahamas, and everybody gonna want to come live here. And then our house price will go up, gal.
So what we waiting on? What's the number?
If you see something, say something. Let us all pitch in and stop the crime before it's your time. Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands. Or text us through the Crack Crime Bahamas app. Stop the crime before it's your time.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. Good to have you with us. Want to let you know, Baja Retreat Spa celebrating Spa Week until Saturday. Spa Week gift certificates start at $50. Stop by and purchase a gift certificate at their location on East Bay Street. Call them at 323-6711 or purchase a gift certificate pardon me, at BajaRetreat.com. You can get massages, facials, manicures, and pedicures, body sugaring at the best deals ever, starting at just $50. During Spa Week, you get 20% off and more on all retail products like Eminence Organic, Pure Fiji, and Camille Rose, and 50% off on PPEs, masks, sanitizers, and much more. It's Spa Week time, and you deserve the best. Check them out. They have the best Spa Week ever. Spa Week gift certificates are now valid for 1 year. Again, the number is 323-6711. You can WhatsApp them at 544-1855. You can find them on Facebook and Instagram. And don't forget to purchase your Spa Week gift certificates online at BajaRetreat.com. All right. So we're talking what's going on in Abaco, and it's a problem. By the way, I want to let you know I won't be here on Friday. I don't think Ken and Nick will be here either. We'll see if we have a guest host or if we're playing a replay. And I'm also on vacation next week. And so, therefore, I will likely not be here every day of the week. I don't know yet what to tell you about which days I will or will not be here. Just to let you know that I haven't been kidnapped by insurgents or rebels or space aliens. I'm just taking some time off. All right. Oh. John Pinder says the number of illegal migrants is about to eclipse the Bahamian population. Now, there are also problems in Eleuthera and some other places with illegal migrants. This is a difficult situation in terms of you want to be sympathetic to people's plight, but you can't just come here and set up shop and do whatever the hell you want. It just isn't going to work. Now, am I naive in thinking that Bahamians are not complicit in this? No, I'm not that naive. I know Bahamians are complicit in it. And as Pinder suggests, I think you should go after the Bahamians too. You're going to tell me all sorts of things about, well, like I can't find regular workers because we don't have housing, we don't have da-da-da, and I go, well, you know, hey, that doesn't mean we could just have no order and people come and set up shop and do whatever on Crown land. Now, Ryan Pinder said they're going to apply to the judge to have these people prosecuted for disobeying the injunction, and he says there's a ruling expected on that next month, and then after that they're going to look to appeal that. And then I say, listen, go ahead and clean up Abaco. You know, you want to be humane, you want to be nice, but that situation is not one that is sustainable. And so you got to deal with the people who are illegal migrants themselves. And then you also have to deal with the Bahamians who are employing them. Now, in terms of people who are born in the Bahamas who should receive some status upon turning 18, that's a different concern, and you have to have a different track for them. So here's what I would do. Since Keith Bell says there's a process, I have no idea what he's talking about. If he's talking about the regular process of apprehension and placing people before the court, that's fine. But if let's just say John Pinder is saying the entire population of Abaco is 10,000 people. Right. And so that therefore he's saying there's almost 5,000 undocumented migrants. You guys got 13. So it's going to take you about 400 visits, maybe 300 visits at least, to even begin to touch what is going on. If John Pinder's numbers are accurate, I don't know that they are. Here's what I would do. And you know what? I find that, and even though the pandemic happened, I found that we wasted so much time profiling after Dorian. You know, everyone wanted to profile. It's about me, me, me. Nobody ever done this before, seen this before, rah, 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 right? All right? We spent so much time profiling after Dorian. No one ever really came up with a solid plan. No one really came up, really pushed through and go, let's make everything happen. Let's do all we can all at once. Did BPL and Carolike do a lot of work down there? Certainly. Did the Water and Sewage Corporation do a lot of work down there? Yeoman's job in a lot of cases, certainly. Was the cleanup of the mud and the peas done pretty well? Yeah, for certain. But, you know, a lot of things were just left to the wayside. The DRA failed miserably. And we just didn't properly facilitate any sort of hardcore presence of law enforcement round the clock on the island that would be able to deal with the problems that were arising, because this ain't no new situation. They were saying there was looting after Dorian. everyone go, oh no, don't say that and this and that, and the people got, anyway, let me stop. Because, you know, everyone go, oh, you're elitist, and you people should loot and rob if they're, you know. All right, man, you know. And then let's apply those rules across the board. People should be able to loot and rob. I should be able to shoot you if you're looting and robbing my property. Yes, I should be able to protect my property and my life by using deadly force if necessary. If we want to have those arguments, so let's put all our cards in the pot. All right. It was a problem back then. It's a problem now. That the government doesn't understand of facilitating housing on Abaco for people employed by the government, such as environmental health workers, such as police officers, more police officers, such as a full-time immigration office, such as a full-time court, to make sure these people are repatriated properly, such as more defense force officers, is just beyond me. Even social services workers, right? Again, immigration officers, that they're missing this opportunity to do this properly on Abaco is just beyond me. And I've seen this movie so often before in the Bahamas, and I'm not saying it's an easy place to govern, right? But I'm saying that a lot of slackness goes down, okay? Lots of slackness. So you're telling me 3 years after Dorian now, it's more than 3 years after Dorian, we had a nice concert, right? We had a series of concerts which were fantastic by all accounts. C.C. Winans brought the house down. But we haven't properly figured out housing on Abaco. We haven't properly figured out robust law enforcement on Abaco. And what you're going to do is just half measure it until the situation's booming out of control. And then human rights groups are going to swoop down and call you Nazis again and all this other stuff like that, leaving blameless those who built illegally and everything like this. What you're going to do is just ignore the people who are employing these workers. You're going to allow yourself to have these leaks in your operation, and I don't have any proof or hard data to support that, but that's what it seems like to me. If Pinder's saying there's thousands, and you go there and end up with 13, 54 in total, and only 13 you're holding at the detention center. And we're just going to let it escalate and escalate and escalate, and slackness on top of slackness on top of slackness. Look around you. Look at Nassau, right? Look at Nassau. Am I saying that this all happened by coincidence, that there are road networks and facilities and utilities and all this? No, I'm not. But I'm saying that look at how we apply commercial zones and residential zones. Look at how we screwed that up. Look at how we screwed up, like, building inside the boundary of where the government says you shouldn't build your house or wall or structure. Look at how we've not kept the drains clean. Look at how we don't pick up the trash properly. Look at how we don't clean up the verges, etc., properly, right? Look at downtown, right? You want to tell me these are impossible challenges that nobody can address? It's just will, right? It's just a will to do it. Now, again, Singapore is different. You think Singapore is going to allow you to have downtown looking the way it is? And property owners are going to go, well, I need... What are you talking about? You're going to have abandoned buildings? Look at all the derelict homes around here that we screw around with, and the inability for us to have a proper land registry and how messed up that is. That's how we operate. Right? Halfway. Don't tell me it isn't. Yeah, we have lots of bureaucracy and lots of laws and everything like that. I see them flouted every day by people who are supposed to be law-abiding. And what you're going to do is you're going to allow Abaco to become an entire mess, and then it's going to be 10 times harder to fix it than it would have been to prevent all of this. So I'm nobody, right? I don't have any deep connection to any underground operations in Abaco. I haven't been to Abaco. I intend to go. I haven't been to Abaco since Dorian. How do I know that shantytowns are exploding in the farm, but the government doesn't? The government whose business it is to know. The government whose land it is that the shantytowns are being exponentially increased on. How do you not know? And then you do what? You look around and go, well, Lidrat, what are you talking about? Set up proper operations, even if it's for 6 months to a year. Invest some money. Pull your head out of the sand. Get a magistrate down there full time. Pay them hazard or whatever the hell it is. Pay. Get a magistrate down there full time. Get a contingent of law enforcement officers down there. Look, I'm not saying there's any shortage of work to do with law enforcement, but if you could send 20 officers to Turks, you can go send 20 to Abaco. I know there's no shortage of people getting murdered around here and all this, but if you can send officers to Turks, if you can deal with, if the UK is looking for our officers, we can spare some for Abaco for an assignment, for an operation. Same with the Defense Force officers. Right now, and we don't have the resources for all this, right now, U.S. naval vessel is docked outside of Port-au-Prince, the main port, trying to enforce a blockade of sorts. We can't put some vessels around Abaco where we see people coming illegally. We can't check for immigration status inside domestic airports. That's too much. Is that fascist or something? I don't know what's what anymore. We don't want to even offend people by asking if they have a passport or a birth certificate or a travel document. We can't absorb all of, not even close. And it's not even all. We can't absorb what's coming. Okay? And you're just going to sit there, and I've seen this before over and over and over and over and over and over and over. Over and over and over and over and over. Don't tell me y'all don't half-step. Don't tell me that. Because if you didn't, then the mud wouldn't have been there in the first place. And many, many, many people wouldn't have died there. Because you know, that's what the thought, well, it's, you know, what it is, they hire me, and people died, right? And you got it going on again, and guess what's going to happen the next time a storm happens? People are going to die because of a cocktail of inaction, of not wanting to face the problem, of not wanting to confront those Bahamians on Abaco who are hiring the undocumented migrants, of not looking at labor, what it is. Well, we're screwed. We're all screwed. It's fine. We're screwed. No problem. Some of us will make it. Some of us won't. It is what it is. Let's go to the phone line. Good afternoon. Why does it keep doing that? Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, Juan. What's up, brother?
Hey, I'm good, man.
Hey, man. Juan, I want to take you back. I want you to rewind your mind back like about, you know, after the hurricane, basically. I could remember, and I still have photos. She's good to say things in your archives. So when things like this come up, you have your facts. I could remember calling your talk show, Dwight, calling talk shows, consistently talking about people sending me aerial drone photos of this area where there was only 7 structural clapboard houses, right? Mm-hmm. And Vaughn, I know I can't call no one name on the radio, but personally, Vaughn, I went to a high-ranking immigration who just recently got a promotion, I assume, last year or whenever, and they do nothing about it.
Wow.
I cried. I called your talk show. I think many times, you know, maybe he might have called name Dave. I don't know. He don't mind me calling his name. He called and he talked about this same situation. But you know what happened? You know what happened, Mr. McCartney? You know what I realized in this country? Because you ain't this one and that one, your opinions or your views don't matter. Like you say, you don't live in Abaco. But we had people. We're sending us aerial footage drone of this area which only had about 7 structural clapboard houses. Now this a whole,
right.
What community, basically?
Correct. Yes.
Which could have been avoided. And now here it is. Now the chickens come home to roost. Right? Everybody up in arms is how they trying to figure out. You mean to tell me from that hurricane happened, the relevant authority was there, didn't see these people were building up that area? And people were on social media, people in Abaco, people all about crying about why these people building back up these areas. It was sad enough that the mud cleared down. That cleared down for a reason. But they still allow these people now it out of hand, and now they're talking about trying to control it. You could have controlled it then.
Yeah, it's much harder to fix now.
You understand, Vaughn? Yeah. It's really harder. You understand what I'm saying? And now here it is now. I'm not putting a plug or trying to speak on behalf of the immigration minister, Mr. Keith Bell. Now the pressure come down on you, sir.
Right.
Sorry to say it like that, but that's the reality of it, because they didn't deal with it then. Now you got to deal with it. Have a good day, my brother.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Yeah, it's a lot. All right, it's a lot, and I'm tired of all the excuse making. I'm tired of all the, you know, people who have pride in their country. They don't allow these things to just happen right under their noses. Now I can see if there's a huge, and even then, right? Because we're not the only people who deal with these issues. But you don't allow half of what I see in this country. You don't allow. When you have some sense of pride, okay? So, again, and sometimes when people aren't, and you try to do the democratic thing, and you try to be like, okay, let's get buy-in X, Y, Z, let's do the charm offensive, right? Then let's look at, sometimes you got to go autocratic, right? And I don't like that either, right? I'm not talking about autocratic, don't leave your yard. I'm talking about if you're not going to maintain the building, we're going to repossess it. If your home is left derelict and your family has some conflict where your sister and your grammy and outside child can't agree on what's happening like that and it rotten to pieces, the government's going to go take it. And we'll sell it to somebody who says that they'll abide by covenants. I have a situation where, here's what's so funny, right? There's a situation where I'm selling, my brother and my sister and I are selling our parents' house because they're both gone now, okay? And the covenants of the subdivision in which this home is located are so restrictive that it requires all of their children to sign off on every single piece of paperwork regarded to the sale of the home. But you know what happens in real, and so that's what happens in the court, right? So the court demands it, and you can't legally sell it unless you're abiding by those covenants. You know what happens in real life, right? Nobody checks, nobody gives a damn. The covenants say you can't build extra buildings on your property. That's all throughout the subdivision. People have chicken coops, man. They're not connected to city sewage, all throughout. So we put up all these laws to make ourselves feel good, and then nobody wants to enforce them. Nobody wants to get hardcore because they're my friend, and I need them to vote for me, and it's my auntie's second cousin, a birthday cake maker, and we don't want to offend them, and we just end up doing stupidity. So with Abaco right now, same thing. We don't want to look crazy, or we're just too lazy to go do it. We don't want to invest the ingenuity and the resources. Same thing. It disappoints me. I'm disappointed. You know, for as much promise and as much talent that we have in this country, there's just often sometimes just a spirit of defeatedness that sometimes permeates from the top down that just makes you sad. This is wholly employers of the work permit holders responsible for housing. They don't have no work permits. They're undocumented. If they had a work permit, they had a document. They don't have no work permit. So I'm saying you have no business there. I don't care who's hired you. You don't allow that in your country when you have some pride in it. Not that you hate anybody from any other nationality. We're not going to, because you don't know what's going on with them. You don't know what conditions they're living in. You know what they're being paid. They're undocumented. People could be taking advantage of them. They could have any, God knows what in there, because they're not going to go to the police. says if they can't provide the housing, cancel the work permits. Also, if any illegals on the land, they should be sent home. We must handle our business and stop being personal about it. It's too much now. Yeah, true. This says, Minister tried to eradicate the shantytown crisis and was blocked. Call a spade. Every other PM is complicit. Minister did try to deal with the shantytowns. I'll give him the credit for that. How he went about it maybe wasn't the smartest way, because that's what actually ended up happening, why there was an injunction done, because they didn't really follow the process properly. I wouldn't say every other PM is complicit. No, I wouldn't say that. You know, complicit and negligent are two different things, right? Says this is a housing crisis. If I put 2,000 container homes down there, the Haitians will not utilize them because it does not fit their motives and they don't want to pay rent. How can an illegal rent from you and those that have status will not pay rent? They don't believe in it because we have not assimilated them to it. Look, man, we got to draw the line somewhere. Is there any doubt that there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people who are here of Haitian descent, whose parents came here legally, got work permits because the process was different, right? And have contributed to this country? There's no doubt about that, right? But it can't be a forever thing with everyone come do whatever you want. Now, I'll say this. Well, anyway, that's a topic for another discussion. There's a way to look at it and assess the work needs XYZ down there in Abaco. But you can't just build whatever the hell you want. And if you're hiring illegal workers, they need to make the investment in providing housing for them, trying to apply for work permits for them. The government's not so uncompassionate that it can, and though this is the policy, it's not so uncompassionate that it goes, look, these people are here. I can employ them. We can help them to build proper housing. They can contribute. That's one way to go about it too, but you don't want to do that, right? It says, Juan, the children of the illegals are immigration and police officers. Who are they going to arrest? Right. Okay. So I reject what you're saying. All right. Out of hand. So just because someone's a child of an immigrant doesn't mean they're not going to do their job. Now, if you have evidence of that, then show me and I'll be happy to agree with you on that. But just out of hand, I reject that. Oh, because I am, because my mother or father was Haitian or Cuban, or Trinidadian or whatever the hell, right? I'm not going to uphold and do my job as a police officer. That doesn't make sense to me because everybody's an immigrant at some point, right? So that means for you to say to me that when I go to the United States and I see all the Hispanic people whose parents came over on boats from maybe Cuba, who also fled and sought asylum and all that, that they're just going to let Hispanic migrants just run roughshod into the United States. That all the police officers in Miami-Dade, just using a thing, let's go different, like Laredo, Texas, right? Or Arizona. All the police officers, all the sheriff's deputies who are of Mexican heritage, whose parents came to the United States illegally, but they were born in the United States, so they're citizens. They're soft on illegal migration because most of the Border Patrol agents in those areas are indeed of Mexican heritage. So for you to tell me, California too, so for you to tell me that because someone's of a particular heritage, they're going to let others of their heritage break the law when they are law enforcement officers, I disagree with that notion. All right, I go to Canada. I see Sikh people who are immigration officers. Are they going to let Indian migrants through, all the Sikh people through, without following the immigration law, right? I see people who are clearly, they look African in nature, right? Yes, you can sometimes tell if someone looks African. Don't be stupid. Are they going to let all the Africans go through? So I reject the notion that just because you have a certain heritage, you're going to let people do it. If you behave and I can let you slide breaking the law, no, not around me. I don't care what you're dealing with. If you my neighbor, I'm going to let you do whatever you want, bring guns into the, oh, they're behaving, let them ride. No, dude. Either you abide by the law or not. All right? That ain't, to me, a no heritage thing. That's just a you thing and your own mores thing. If you're a law enforcement officer, I expect you
to uphold the law, period. And there's tons of people on police force who are of Haitian descent. There's tons of people on defense force of Haitian descent. And their job is to uphold the law. And for the most part that I'm aware of, they do that. Now, if you got information otherwise, you let me know. All right? All right, let's take a break, Arlene, and we'll come back.
We foster love in everything we do, and our signature sandwiches are no different. Stop on by and try our all-new Buffalo Ranch Chicken Sandwich. We have taken the chicken sandwich and kicked it up a notch. Taste our Louisiana Cajun seasoned chicken patty, served on a brioche bun with two pickles and drizzled with our all-new Buffalo Ranch sauce. Add a chocolate chip cookie on your order for only 90 cents. Stop by any Popeyes for your Buffalo Ranch Chicken Sandwich today.
Love that chicken from Popeyes.
Hey Lisa, AHR Fidelity's free Women Plus seminar is back.
Oh yes it is. My ladies and I are ready to go.
Well, I heard it's open for men too, so you know my crew and I will be there.
The highly anticipated free Fidelity Women Plus seminar will be held on Saturday, October 29th at the Bahama Convention Center as we explore solutions towards achieving financial freedom.
The Women's Plus seminar is free and includes breakfast, 8 sessions, plus over $8,000 in prizes and surprises. Registration and breakfast begin at 8 a.m. with sessions from 9:30 a.m. to 2 p.m.
Space is limited, so register now for free at fbbwomanplus.com.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and generators back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
If you were exposed to COVID-19, have symptoms, or traveled recently, get tested so that you can have peace of mind about your status. Just visit one of our convenient locations on New Providence at the University of the Bahamas or Golden Gates Plaza, weekdays 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Saturdays 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. On Eleuthera at the Three Island Dock, Mondays through Thursdays, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., Fridays and Saturdays, 8 a.m. to 7 p.m., and Sundays, 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. On Exuma at the Regatta Park, weekdays, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., Saturdays, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Sundays, 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. On Abaco at Maxwell Food Store, Mondays through Saturdays, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The COVID-19 test results will be ready in 15 minutes, and the tests are free.
This message is brought to you by PAHO WHO and the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
We'll be right back.
your way.
Double shot decaf cappuccino.
Light roast Colombian no milk.
You do vacations your way.
Hiking boots, tent,
mountains.
Five-star hotels and theater.
And now you can do insurance your way.
Online.
Email.
Chat.
WhatsApp.
Or in branch. For home, car, travel, boat, or business insurance, do it anyway with NUA Insurance agents and brokers. Visit NUAinsurance.com, call, or stop by a branch today.
Fidelity's free Women Plus seminar is back. Join us on Saturday, October 29th at the Bahama Convention Center, where leading professionals will give you the hard facts on topics like
How to Be Rich 101, How Your Mental and Emotional Health Impact Financial Health, and What I Wish Women Knew About Men,
and How to Get Their Money. This free, life-changing event is for women and men. The seminar includes breakfast, 8 sessions, plus over $8,000 in prizes and surprises. Registration and breakfast begins at 8 a.m., with sessions from 9:30 a.m. to 2 p.m.
Space is limited, so register now for free at fbbwomenplus.com.
If you want value and flavor, check out the King Meal Deals at Burger King Nassau. Enjoy your choice of a Big King Jr. or a Chicken Big King Jr. with fries and a drink for only $5.75, including VAT. The Big King Jr. features Burger King's signature flame-grilled beef topped with some of your favorite fixins and king sauce on a sesame seed bun, or indulge in the Chicken Big King. Either way, you get value, flavor, fries, and a drink the BK way for only $5.75. Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Hey, it's spa week, we got what you need. Sit back, relax, and come in for a treat. We just wanna make you smile. We will go the extra mile. Baja Retreat Spa.
Come visit us at Baja Retreat Spa on East Bay Street. Contact us at 323-6711. Or visit us online on www.baharetreat.com.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. And as well, McCartney, good to have you with us. And I want to let you know that the OWN Foundation regrets to inform you that due to health and safety protocols, OWN Talks Thrive 2022 will be postponed. The OWN Foundation will honor all reserved tickets on a new date to be announced. OWN looks forward to hosting you and inspiring future and current entrepreneurs to thrive on the new date to be announced. All right.
Okay, so we're talking about the situation on Abaco, and it just leads me into a profound sense of disappointment about what's happening. It says Bahamians want to be tourists. They only live for the weekend, holidays, and trips to South Florida. It's most likely they're not on private property. Most likely not. They're not on private. They're on government property. They're on Crown land. Here's what's true, right? There can always be people who break the law. There are always going to be people who flout the law. There are always going to be people who are slack about the law. Always, 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 always. It's just part of human nature. We're flawed as human beings, and oftentimes we'll try to get away with what we can get away with, no matter how strict your systems, etc. Right? But if people who are looking to circumvent the law, who are looking for an easy path to do things that are illegal, build illegally, if they know that you're not checking, if they know that ain't nothing going to happen to you, they're going to take advantage of it. You think they're building out there at the farm because they think the government's really on top of things and really strict and is paying attention? As I said, it's shameful that you had to act on this after the last time John Pinder spoke about it. You knew that was going on down there. You knew that. You knew that. Right? Yet you did nothing. And it's not even, and I'm not even saying, oh, well, Minnis, yada, yada, yada. Minnis too. Minnis knew. This was happening under his watch. They were building up on the farm. This didn't all just happen a year ago. And they go, well, Brave's in now. Let's go and go wild. The previous government knew too. I don't know why they're out here fronting. Like, oh, we had it under control. You had nothing under control. Zilch. All right. So please. It says they keep trying to give Minnis credit about the shanty town, but all governments went to court. Carl Bethel didn't challenge the injunction for 2 years. Stop patting people on the back for failures. Yeah, most governments went to court over and over and over again for trying to deal with this issue. But there's not a robust effort, man, in my eyes. I mean, show me otherwise. I've been watching this for a long time. I see us kind of approach it and look at it and dance around it a bit. And we do apprehend people for certain, but if something's blowing up like it is in Abaco, you check for it, right? Eleuthera is an issue. Andros is an issue. We were condemned for even printing a local councilor saying, look, there's a serious problem with illegal migrants here on Andros. I mean, condemned. And you know who the majority of the people who condemn us? People who don't have any interaction with illegal immigrants. Right, people who sit in boardrooms and country clubs, golf clubs, right, and want to make themselves feel better. And so when you're telling Bahamians who are dealing with this issue in real time that oh, it's just you're xenophobic, you're XYZ, it's like that's not really helping me. Do we often talk about these issues in really pejorative terms? Yeah. But they are issues, all right? Lots of things are. It says, so to that texter's point, if you were an immigration officer, are you going to arrest your uncle and aunt to be deported to a country in peril? I mean, okay, to suggest that I'm going to be dealing with my uncle or aunt, I don't know. That seems like a stretch. How many aunts and uncles do you have? How regular an occurrence is that? This says party members own Crown land and collect rent. This is the bottom line. Well, they would lease the land. Great show as usual. Part of the problem is our lust for cheap labor and also lust over the $100 bill. Illegal people are renting some of the properties and buildings in Abaco. Yeah, that is true. Yep, we want cheap labor. These governments are making Lincoln Bain look like a modern-day Martin Luther King. Okay. Sure, man. Sure. Yeah. Certainly. The parallels are striking between Lincoln Bain and Martin Luther King Jr. I don't know how I missed that before. You keep telling yourself that. It says, Juan, you think someone is getting bribed to turn a blind eye, or are we just incredibly slack? I mean, maybe there's bribery involved, I don't know, but slackness is certainly a part of the equation. It says, we do have the resources to solve our immigration problem, but because Abaco is highly funded by second homeowners, and they're the main ones hiring migrant workers for cheap labor, the government keeps a blind eye in order to get that foreign currency into the country. Okay. It says, I'm confused. If people are squatting on Crown land, who are they paying rent to? Well, if they pay and rent to anyone and they're on Crown land, then that's on them. But I wouldn't put it past someone to go, it's my land and pay me rent and everything, and they know it's Crown land. But I don't know who they'd be paying rent to. That's Crown land where the farm is. All right, that's government land. I'm so lost at this point. And what's so stupid, right? What's so pellucid anyway? I'm gonna get myself in trouble. That's Crown land, and I don't understand what's happening. And I don't understand how an injunction can cover illegal building on Crown land without the Crown's permission. I don't get it. I don't know how that is allowed to happen. I don't know what sense that makes or what logic dictates that. Now, if you're saying the land and the mud and the peas is in dispute, and we don't know who owns what, X, Y, Z, but you don't just get to go squat on government Crown land. I guess in the Bahamas you do. I guess around here you do. Anyway, Ali, I hear there's great fishing in the Exumas. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to do me. Y'all let whatever the hell happened to Abaco happen, since only me out here caring about it, checking for it. Everyone, well, there's a process, and, you know, the thing quadruple, we're going to look at it. So people benefiting are the business owners in Abaco. They use this scenario to stop the influx of other Bahamians into Abaco. Yeah, I agree. You need to target the business owners. They're not exempt. Juan, let government do what your cousins say. Knock down the illegal houses and deal with the courts later. You know, I don't believe in that either. I mean, I don't believe in doing it that way. I'm saying you go out there, you put the notices on the houses, you are here, you are building on Crown land, the structure is not authorized to have here, we're going to give you 14 days to move out, right? Now, if you need to, we can send the social service worker, figure out what's going on, who got documents, who don't got documents. If you ain't got documents, you got to go. If you're entitled to some sort of status, or you should be registered for some sort of status when you hit 18 or whatever like that, we could look at that. If you have someone who's employing you who's willing to go through the proper work permit process, we could look at that too. Here's what I also know is true, and I want you to look at this. And this isn't a fully cooked idea in my head, but I want you to look at it, right? So the last Christie administration changed the work permit process, right? So, and I'm of two minds about it. I think it did more harm than good. But I do understand why they did it. But I think public outcry and then having a sense of what works well for public policy are two different things. So beforehand, as far as I'm aware, you could apply for a work permit in the Bahamas. Okay? The last Christie administration said you cannot apply for a work permit in the Bahamas. Not only can you not apply for a work permit in the Bahamas, you cannot
have a work permit without making sure that people have proper housing and proper accommodation, XYZ, that they have healthcare, etc. Now, people didn't follow all of that, but they did follow the thing where you can no longer apply for your work permit in the Bahamas. If you already have a work permit, you can reapply, certainly. That didn't stop the numbers of work permits. It didn't have the desired effect. So you were doing that to show out for Bahamians, who were talking about it's too many migrant workers, when the problem ain't necessarily the migrant workers, the problem is the undocumented migrant workers. Not the set who have work permits. Because, be real, y'all ain't into cleaning no yard and working no farm. Let's be real. The majority of Bahamians, I'm not pigeonholing everyone, you're not a monolith. Let's be real. When Chester Cooper gets up and says there's $1.2 billion in investment for Exuma, and Bahamians could jump up on Facebook with their 3BJC in home economics and needlework, okay, that they barely passed, and go, slave labor! Working in the hotels for slaves, you gonna go work on any farm? You gonna go weed someone yard? Word? Let me know. Because you think working in a working in air condition with benefits and with it, you think that's, you call that slave labor. Mind you, the slaves didn't get paid, but whatever. Right? So let's be real. People are going to have work permits for people they want to work for them because they know they're hard workers. It is what it is. So the Minnis administration then went ahead and dramatically increased the cost of work permits across the board. Doubled it for most regular worker jobs. That did not decrease the number of work permits. It increased immigration revenue. But people said, I want to hire these workers, whether it's housekeeping, whether it's labor, XYZ, whether they're Haitian, whether they're Filipino, we want to hire them. Even though we'll have to pay more, we got to pay more for the work permit, etc., and jump through more hoops, we'll still do it. So I don't know that all the tinkering with the work permit, I don't know that all the, oh, we're going to limit work permits, so we're going to go hardcore with the work, I don't know that that's doing anything. I don't know that that works at all. So when we're having this discussion about what to do with work permits, I don't know that putting the cost up is doing anything other than straining businesses that are saying, I want these migrant workers. It's certainly not deterring them from getting the permits. All right. There's subsectors in the Bahamas where people say, I can't find Bahamians to work for me. They're not going to farm and do it consistently and work hard at it. And we also have this dichotomy where people, they blame the migrants and they go, okay, well, the migrants are taking Bahamian jobs. And then they also go, well, the migrants are doing all the crime. So the migrants are all these things, both doing all the crime, both taking Bahamian jobs. Look, the point is this. If we're not proactive about these things, if we just kind of poke at it and shift some things around and don't go whole hog, then nothing's going to get better and nothing's going to get fixed. It's only going to get worse. All right? And we can look at it. And we can try to blame others. But if we don't take a common sense, like serious approach to it, we're not going to get anywhere. So let's be serious about it. That's what I'm saying. This is, I have a bone to pick with that Exuma investment. It is great, but not strategic or sustainable. We can't keep hopping islands with who gets investment based on the PM's constituency or island of birth. Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know how it's, maybe it's not strategic, but I don't know how it's not sustainable. If someone's running a business and they must know if their business is, they have a business plan or a business model or something, they must know that there's a market for it. I'm saying we should diversify our economy too, but I'm saying when you jump up and tell me it's slave labor to work in a hotel, I don't understand what you're talking about. Like you've lost me. Like I worked at the hotel, at several hotels, and I never felt like a slave. Did I want more money? Sure. Was I qualified to run my own business? Not at the time. Was I equipped to own a hotel and make it successful? No, not at all. was I in a position to be capitalized to own my own hotel? No, clearly not. But I don't get when you say slave labor. Like I'm profoundly insulted, actually. It says, no, I mean for the country, every 5 years we switch island investment strategy. Oh, which island investment? Yeah, I mean, I don't know that. Yeah, you have a point. I don't know that that works. Yeah, the way that they're talking about it. All right, we got time for a call. Let's do a call. And then we're gonna get out of here. This saddens me. Like, the situation saddens me. Like, that we look at it and just go, oh, right. Nope, no biggie. We'll see. There's a process involved. Your process isn't working. You don't see that? Certainly not quickly enough. All right, good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Well, it is talking away the law you want.
Hey, man, what's happening?
I'm right here holding. We need justice, law, and order in this country, the Bahamas. Couple of things I want to put to your attention. The people in Abaco, when they go look for a job, right? Uh-huh. I know the people that live there realize that those people were around there someplace in order for them to give them a job. Okay? So the government had fell down. Okay? If people were going to build, they have to go to government to get permits and whatever. It would show where the land is and everything like that, right? Uh-huh. Government's supposed to know what's happening. Well, government was nasty with situation as such by not, you know, checking to see what's happening. The other part is, right, people are always talking about farming. The thing is, you go into food stores, hardly anything in the food store would be farmed in the Bahamas.
Yep.
And the other thing is, right, now this bunch of foolishness would happen in the Bahamas, right, crime and everything like that, the illegals, they go from here to America. When I could have seen and when I used to travel, right, people used to be proud of the Bahamas and the people that comes over there. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. They respected them. But nothing happening now. Bahamians are getting killed in America now. I know somebody which had gotten killed, and I've heard of other Bahamians which had gotten killed. You know? The government's just nasty. I'm going to twist a little bit. Just southeast of Government House, there was a food store, City Market, right? Mm. You go on that ground right now, government took it over, right?
Right.
Bought the building.
And the dilapidated structure is right there. Yeah.
Right. And some people making it a garbage haven.
Yeah.
And the same thing when it comes to, not the same thing, but when it comes to Parliament Street, south of Shirley Street, mm-hmm. on the eastern side, all kind of hedges. And the same thing with East Hill Street, all sort of hedges.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
The government got to wake up.
I agree.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, we got to get out of here. So... before we go, the OWN Foundation regrets to inform you that due to health and safety protocols, OWN Talks Thrive 2022 will be postponed. The OWN Foundation will honor all reserve tickets on a new date to be announced. We look forward to hosting you and inspiring future and current entrepreneurs to thrive on the new date to be announced. All right, if you won your JBLN tickets, I'm going to leave them at the front desk for you. You got to pick them up. The South Souths on Saturday. Don't just leave these tickets here and be hitting me up for fun now, because I could have given these to somebody who would have went and done it. So make sure you come get them. All right, we got to get out of here. That's going to do it for the show today. You guys take care out there and have a great day, Bahamas.